This time, I'd just like to offer up a little bit of special recognition for our graduates this morning. We have a gift for you, which is basically a card that has been handwritten by somebody within this congregation to make it a little more personal, but it also has a gift card for you. But before I do this individually, let me just congratulate you, because I know for many of you it's been a long, hard journey. I do notice we have a little blue, hence the green, some red. You know what that has to mean, I guess, in a way. All right, so anyway, first of all, and I'm just going to say their names. I don't know if you've noticed this, you probably have already seen it, but the family in your bulletin has got information about each of them. I'm not going to go through all of that, but Madison, you're going to be the first one. Jeremy's going to meet you right here, and you're just going to line up. Cool. Everybody good with that? All right, so first of all,
slideshow.
Who?
Slideshow.
Oh, you want to show the slideshow? Oh, okay, sorry, y'all. I thought y'all would be surprised today. Even me.
Yeah.
First of all, we're going to recognize Madison Blaylock. I want you to take note to these songs, if you don't mind, because they were strategically chosen for you, with a message for you that hopefully you can carry with you as you remember this day. Thank you.
Please stand and join me as we sing together.
Christ,
It's a great question. freedom to make of this life what we want to make of it. Are you with me? He is giving us the freedom to make of it what we want to make of it. And so when you read things like the kings and you see a good king and a bad king, well, just because you're good parents, listen, does not guarantee your kids are going to make the same choice. There is no formula in the text that says that if you do this, we read that proverb wrong, but that's another message for another time. But there is no guarantee that my kids are going to for sure walk with God, treasure Christ, and choose to follow Him. There's just no guarantee to it. So here's the point. We have no excuse. Does it really matter what's gone on before? Okay? I mean, well, I shouldn't say it doesn't matter, but a lot of times we use the past as an excuse and say, well, I'm this because of this. You know, no, God's given us freedom to make a choice. And so regardless of what has come before, the question and challenge to our graduates is, what are you going to make of it? What are you going to make of the future? What are you going to make beyond this new transition in your life as you begin to go on into college, or you graduate from college and enter the work world, or enter marriage, enter family life, and all of it? What are you going to make of it, right? So what God has led me to do this week is share with you about a guy that does not get talked about very much. As a matter of fact, from all that I can tell, he's only mentioned 3 times in the Bible. And his name is Epaphras, if I'm even getting that right, okay? But from Epaphras' life, what's unique for me is that he's a third-generation guy. And so sometimes we wonder where we're like, well, here's Jesus, and we'll just never achieve Jesus-likeness and all of those things. Well, Paul did. Well, what about those that Paul ministered to? Well, Epaphras is one of those third-generation guys that we see it being able to reproduce the life of Christ in that third generation. So it is possible, even many, many generations that we're at today. It is possible. You and I have the freedom to make of it what we want to make of it. And so, with all of that in mind, you know, I go back to a very important phrase of Paul. And it's a phrase that you can write this verse down, 1 Corinthians 11:1. I think it shows up one other time in 1 Corinthians. But here was the message from those who came after Jesus. The message was, imitate me as I imitate Christ. So when we go all the way back to the beginning, see what happens to us is we lose sight of what the standard is. We begin to allow people, whether it's a preacher, whether it's a Sunday school teacher, or some influential person in our life, and it could be a denomination. What happens is we allow somebody else to lead us off track into some other standard than what it was in the beginning. And in the beginning, let me just remind you, the standard was Jesus. It was His life. So if you really are serious, graduate, about knowing what the Christian life is about, can I give you some great wisdom right here? Just study the life of Jesus. If there's anybody, I mean, you see what I'm saying? Because whatever I tell you that it might be, it all needs to be laid beside the ultimate standard of Jesus and checked there before anywhere else. Because you know we have a tendency over time to get away from things that are important. And so anyway, Jesus has always been the standard. But as we look at the life of Epaphras, what we see revealed here is the formula for life. The formula for life. Because I don't want anybody in this building. As a matter of fact, I pray God crosses my path with people out there that I get the opportunity to help people experience what true life is all about. So we're going to talk about, from Epaphras' life, the formula for life. So I hope you graduates and others will write these down. I hope you'll keep them forever. Because what plus what equals true life, eternal life. Okay, so let's walk through this formula together. The first thing that we'll say, where it all begins with this one thing, and that is treasuring Jesus Christ. It all starts, life all Jesus Christ. I want to call your attention to some different places. If you don't want to turn with me, you can just see it there. But I call your attention to the book of Colossians. Again, there's only three verses in the Bible that contain this man's name, but yet a guy that was making a huge impact. But Colossians chapter 4, verse 12 is where I want us to look. Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. So verse 12 reads, Epaphras, who is one of you, now notice this phrase, I like this phrase, a bondservant of Christ. He greets you always. Notice what he's doing, always laboring fervently for you in prayer. What's he praying? Well, he's praying that you, Church of Colossae, will stand perfect. Perfect not meaning like without sin, like you never mess up, right? But what he means there is that you stand mature in Christ. Because here's the thing about life, right? When the baby is born, I mean, they begin. I mean, anybody in here ever had kids? Raise your hand if you've got kids. So I just want to know, there's a lot of people who are helping me with this testimony. So you have kids, and the moment they're born, here's what's happening. They're screaming, me, me. Is that not right? And see, the problem is some people never get out of that. Right? They never stop screaming me. Okay? Anybody like that? So when a baby is born, I mean, it's like, man, feed me, change me, hold me. I mean, whatever. It's just me, 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 me. And so you would hope just in the process of the natural life that people would grow up to begin to realize it's not about you, okay? But the same way is within the family of God. Because listen, you're not born a child of God. You're not born into this world a child of God. You're not born with spiritual life. I mean, that's a doctrine that is so crystal clear in the scripture, right? You're born with the need for spiritual life. And that's what makes Jesus so awesome. That's what makes him something that those of us who have seen the glory of Christ and the glory of the cross, we understand why, you know, he's so important and treasure that and treasure him, right? But in the Christian realm, the same is true. Okay, we forget this, but when you're born again, you know, the Bible refers to you as being carnal, okay? It's just because you're born again, I mean, it doesn't mean that your whole life at that moment you're absolutely mature. No, the Bible talks about a growth process. So even within that, you know, it's a process whereby God is working you out of you, if that makes any sense. God's working the self out of you, because really, if Jesus is the standard, then we know that he didn't live for him. He lived for who? He lived for everybody else. But that's the maturity process. It's the growth process in the Christian life. And so, Epaphras is one who was praying for that maturity. He was longing for them to move out of being carnal and being all about them to growing up and being mature to where it would be about everybody else. And not only that, but that they would love. And remember, true agape love is seeking the highest good for another without anything in return. And what is the highest good? Well, the highest good is a relationship with God. So again, you can understand his passion and why he's praying for maturity, right? He's praying for them to stand perfect and complete in all of the will of God. Because when they get to that point, really they don't need anybody else. They're ready to function on their own. And not only are they ready to function on their own, but they're able to what? Reproduce. But the phrase here that you may not realize how it's connected to treasuring Christ, but the phrase here that tells us that Epaphras treasured him was the phrase that he was a bondservant. It's the word doulos in the Greek. It's a word that literally means a slave. But the beautiful thing about this word is that in that context, in that culture, and you've heard me say this many times, but I gotta say it again, in that culture, it referred to someone, okay, who had actually been bought. You know, this individual, this slave would be bought, and they would be paid for, but rather than them being forced to serve that one who bought them, they were set free. But in that freedom, and in going out and surveying all of the employment opportunities that were out there, the decision was made in their own heart to go back to the one that bought them and set them free and basically say, here I am, whatever you want, I will be your slave. Wow. I mean, who are you going to do that to? Who are you going to just basically bow before and say, I'm here at your beck and call. Whatever you say is going to be final. Whatever you say is how I'm going to move. If you say go here, I'm going here. If you say go there, I'm going there. Whatever you say. I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to bow and give anybody that right unless you treasure them and see them as someone very precious in your life. Some of you young people, you do that with your parents. Some of you don't. That doesn't necessarily mean you don't treasure your parents or appreciate them, but you might ought to think about all that, right? But there are people in this physical realm that we do that to because we respect them, we appreciate them, we love them. And so we allow them in to say this. But you see, that's how I know. Because this isn't a Epaphras going, hey, yo, I'm a bondservant. I mean, this is the testimony of someone who I've seen him, I've been with him, I've watched him. Jesus is that man's Lord. He calls the shots. Hey, graduate, regardless of the past, you have that opportunity. Whether you recognize it today or not, Christ has been paid for you. Your freedom is there for a gift. You have an opportunity to receive that. And in doing so, you have complete freedom to make of it what you want to make of it. But why would you not willingly and joyfully say, and how could I have it any better? Would I go out here and give myself up to Satan and let him be in charge of my life? But see, some of you are doing that right now. Some of you right now, man, Satan calls the shots. He says this to you. Now, in your mind, you may not realize that, but with God, it's only there's no middle ground. And I stand firm on there's no middle ground. There's good, there's evil, there's God, there's the devil. You're either a child of God or a child of the devil. Either Jesus is calling the shots, or either he's calling the shots. It's just that simple. So where does it all start? Where does this formula of life begin? It starts with treasuring Christ. Now, write down, or either way you can see it, Philemon chapter 1, where there's only one chapter in Philemon, but verse 23, look what it says about Epaphras. Paul refers to him here as my fellow prisoner in Christ. Can I ask you a question? Why is Paul in prison? Is he a murderer? Is he a thief? Why is he in prison? You know why he's in prison? You're telling the truth. And I don't mean just like getting in some political figure's face and telling them something, you know, like me. You know, I'm not just talking about telling the truth of the gospel. Preaching Jesus and him crucified. That's why he's in prison. Let me ask you a question. Are you willing to go to prison for your faith in Jesus? Some of you sitting in this room will see it before you die. I believe it with all my heart. God's tired of playing games. He's about to separate sheep from the goats. You're in, you're out. It's one or the other. Question is, are you willing to go to prison? I've had two dreams as of late, very vivid dreams. And these dreams have both been me. In both situations, I won't go into great detail, but both situations, I was being in prison because of what I believed. Because at first, what's going to happen is they're going to target people like me. They're going to try to shut people like me up who are feeding you all of this stuff that's found in this book. You do understand that. So it's not going to be you that's going to be targeted. It's going to be me. But then you will have to make a decision either to stand with your pastor or not. And I'm telling you, it's going to be one of those little fine line things where all you got to do is just compromise a little bit. Just a little bit. It's all you're going to have to do is stay on your feet and avoid the persecution that will come. But here's my point with all this. You are only going to go to jail for something you believe with all of your heart, that you treasure with every fiber of your being. Would you not agree? Would you not agree? So in his life, even though there's only three mentions of his name, man, we find out a lot about this guy. And the most important thing that we realize is that he treasures Christ, listen, above his own. Where it starts. Now, here's what's interesting. I cannot stand here and command you to treasure Christ. I mean, I can stand here and scream it like, you better do this, you better do that. I mean, I can do it, but that's not how it happens. How does it happen? Well, it happens when you see the glory of Christ. And when you see the glory of cross, what he did for you, when you see the glory of the empty tomb, and you see it, you wonder, now how do I even know this? Well, think about the disciples. I mean, Jesus spends all this time with these guys, and man, they're just kind of floundering around, they're not getting it, and then you got Peter, who Jesus even tells him, hey, before this day's out, you're going to deny me three times, and he stands up, no way I'm going to deny you, I'll die with you. Oh, okay, Peter. We'll see, I guess. Well, then when the time comes, what does he do? He does deny. And here's Jesus all alone. And you know, we wonder, like, this is at the end of his earthly life. And you know, today we judge so many things by how big the crowd is. But at the end of Jesus' life, if we say that success is found in how many people follow you, then let me ask you something. How successful was Jesus at the very end? This is not just Peter. It's very specific in Matthew's gospel that every single one of his close followers forsook him in that time. Why did they forsake him? Because they didn't treasure him. Why did they not treasure him? Because they really didn't know who he was. So what made the difference? I'm going to tell you what made the difference. The light switch went on. And they finally realized, just like Peter in Acts 3, when he stood before the same people just 40-some days, or maybe 50 days. 50 days after Jesus dies, he's buried, he's resurrected, he ascends into heaven, right? And so 50 days after that, Peter is standing before the same crowd that crucified him, and he's preaching the gospel, and he looks at all of them and says, this one whom you crucified, God has made him both Lord and Christ. Something clicked. And now something has happened to the point of where he treasures Christ. What he has discovered about Christ is so treasured that he's willing to lay it all on the line. That's where true life begins. When we treasure Christ. Again, you can't command it. All that we can do is proclaim the gospel and pray that the light comes on. That's what we pray. Pray that as God through man, as he speaks the truth into the heart, into that darkness, into that chaos, we pray for the light to come on. See, the truth is that's not that. That can't possibly happen unless the gospel is proclaimed. I mean, if be one thing for me to say, okay, God, save them. But at some point, the gospel's going to have to go in. So what the church has to do is we've got to ask ourselves, do we really treasure Christ? Do we really want him to be famous in our lifetime? Do we want them to hear the message? Do we want them to see the message being lived out? That's what we've got to ask ourselves. It's what you've got to deal with, graduate, as you move into the future, because you can be the start of something amazing. Just one person. You can be the start of a brand new generation that says, no, we're playing church, man. Jesus said, if you want to serve me, follow me. You know what? I'm going to follow him. And I'm going to hold him up as the standard. And I'm going to believe things like he said, you'll do even greater things than I've done. Matthew 13, verse 44 is just a verse I want you to write down and remember, but listen to it. Jesus is giving quite a few parables here that relate to the kingdom, and one of those is back in verse 44. Here's what he says. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and he hid, and from joy over it, he goes and he sells all that he has, and he buys the field. Well, is it the field that's important? No, it's the treasure that is contained in the field that is important to him. That's what the kingdom is like. There's a discovery. There's a moment when something supernatural, when the heart is open, when the spiritual eyes are able to see the beauty and the glory of Jesus Christ. And when that happens, then you will treasure him. So within this point of treasuring Christ, I want to just take a moment, because I'm probably not going to get much further than this, okay? But I want to take a moment to share with you the gospel and just kind of give you a nutshell and just provide the opportunity. Because it'd be one thing to talk about treasuring Christ and never say anything about the good news. Because if I came to you right now, if I walked out there and I stuck a mic in your face and I said, sir, would you please tell us all what is the gospel? What would you tell me? I say, ma'am, would you just take a moment? What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? What is the gospel of the grace of God? What is it? Do you know what it is? Well, first of all, Genesis is huge. Genesis is huge. Why is Genesis so important? Because there's two chapters of God creating, right? And then there's chapter 3 when everything goes crazy. And what happened in chapter 3? Well, man disobeyed God. Now that may not sound like much, but here's something that I have to speak into this graduation group and to those of you that are moving. Here's the deal with the gospel. The reason that Jesus is such good news is because the bad news is so bad. Hey, I'm listening to guys out here. I'm trying to. And here's one thing that is missing. Here's one thing that is missing from a lot of these new movements. Nobody wants to talk about the issue of sin. And how in the world can I trust Christ as Savior? But I don't understand how serious the sin problem really is for me.
Amen.
Are y'all with me? But nobody wants to talk about it. And my whole thing is, how in the world can you preach the gospel? And come to really treasure Christ if you don't understand what had to be done by God so that you could go from death to life. So, sin is a big deal. Write that down. I mean, you know, and I'm just saying that Genesis, it doesn't really start there. But when you look at Genesis, you can see how God created everything. You can see the ideal from God, because he put his stamp on everything. Everything he did, it was good, right? And after all of that, his crown jewel of creation was Adam, and then Eve, and everything was there. And man was able to experience the ultimate in being able to we miss it because they were created in His image, right? We were created in His image. Have you ever read that in your Bible? Have you ever stopped to consider what that might mean? Like, hey, God is invisible, is He not? I mean, His handiwork is everywhere, but God is invisible. So God, in His infinite wisdom, chose a way to make Himself known in the world. And it was through Adam. It was through Eve. And so, this is to say you showed up from outer space somewhere. And you thought, oh, I want to know what God's like. Go check Adam and Eve now. That's what God did. But here's what we miss, is chapter 3. Like, you might just read that and you say, ah, they just ate some fruit or whatever that fruit was from the tree. They just did it. But that's not how Paul defines it. It's not how he saw it. Because here's what happened. That disobedience, according to Romans 5, it brought into our world sin, which with sin, according to God, not with Romans, with sin was going to be attached what? What was going to be attached to sin when it happened? Death. And that is the two things, I'm telling you, 100% of us that live on planet Earth, that's the two things, ladies and gentlemen, that you got to try to figure out how to deal with. It's your sin, because at some point in your life, whether you believe in God or not, you have done something, and there has been something within you that said that was wrong. And according to the text, God wired you that way because your conscience is in there telling you there is a sin. There is a right. There is a wrong. And you violated it. And now you're guilty. God says whether you've got the law or not, whether you've got what's written or not, you're still guilty. And you're without excuse. See, the sin thing is a big deal because, again, I'm just reading my Bible. And these are not little issues that we debate, but it's just very clear that, again, with sin comes attached this thing of death. And you might be like, well, I know everybody's going to die. No. We're not talking about that. We're talking about spiritual death. Because you've only got one block of life here. And then what's going to happen? Okay, you're going to die physically, yeah, but you don't want to die spiritually. Because if you die spiritually, you die apart from Christ and apart from being born again, then you're going to experience a second death, an eternal death, where you're going to be separated from God forever in a place, listen, that was initially prepared for the devil and his fallen angels. But if you want to follow the devil, listen, you're going to go with him. That's Bible, y'all. So think about it. Adam and Eve do this, and this is why Genesis 3 is so huge. They do this, and so now you've got two sinners deserving of death. Now you've got two people that are void of spiritual life. They had it, but they forfeited it. Now they're having a child. So let me ask you the question. Do sinful parents, do spiritually dead parents come together, have a kid? Who's that child going to be? What's he going to be like spiritually? They're going to be alive spiritually? I mean, you got two spiritually dead parents having a kid. I'm telling you, spiritual death plus spiritual death equals spiritual death. So you can believe this hogwash of the world that wants to try to tell you through the media and through Hollywood and all these famous, wealthy people that want to say, oh, all of us are born children of God, but that's not what the book says. Now, if you want to deny the book, then you have that right to do it. But this says, God's special revelation to you says, this thing of sin is a big deal. Because you can't separate sin from its consequence, which is death. And I know some of you have gone through some really difficult times in your life, your own life, your family's life, with sin and all these different things. But just think about it. How destructive has it been? And that's one thing about sin is it's never an isolated incident. See, people get convinced that, oh, I'm just doing this over here on the side, not bothering anybody. No, it's going to affect you, and it's Sin kills. It always kills. I mean, do you honestly think when Adam and Eve were standing over their dead son Abel, I mean, do you really think they're proud of the decision that they made? I mean, really, when they're looking at their dead child, I mean, do you think they're just like, man, we hit it, baby. We done something here now. No. We're seeing the effects of it all around us. So at the end of the day, Paul sums it up best. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And because all have sinned, Paul also says that the payment for that sin is dead. That's how we're born into the world. But here's the thing, and I'll close with this. Even though sin is a big deal, here's what I've learned. Jesus is a bigger deal.
Amen.
He is a bigger deal. Where sin abounds, grace. I see some of you think I'm full of whatever. But here's the thing. But just imagine in your mind if you really did believe that, though. Let me ask you this. How many of you would treasure Christ then, knowing that Christ is the only provision of God available to save you from your sin and spiritual death? How many of you would treasure Christ then? Well, the logical answer is absolutely, man. I mean, it's just like finding the cure for cancer, for goodness sake. I mean, it's like, how many of you would treasure that guy or that girl that found that cure? And see, you live in a world that's constantly bombarding you with the fact that there are many ways to God. So if you believe that garbage, then you're never going to treasure Christ. Your only treasure the way that you see out. And to me, that's pretty cut and dry as well, because you're either going to trust in Him or you're in some way through another religion going to trust in yourself and your own ability to make it happen. Jesus is the bigger deal. So I want you just, as we close, to look at these verses, man, real quick, in 1 John. And I'm just going to read them, make a couple comments, out of here. Just listen to these verses. 1 John chapter 1 can say a lot, but I'll just read, let the word speak to you. But if we, verse 7, but if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Glory, hallelujah. I mean, how more specific do you, if we walk in the light, and all that means is that we choose the truth of God. We walk in the light as God is in the light. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Is that not good? I mean, for some of you that already believe, man, that's a great reminder, right? But it's very specific, right? It's very narrow. It's not just any blood. It's the blood of Jesus that cleanses from what? From all sin. So that doesn't exclude anybody from this, does it? Man, that opens the door up like, man, come in. Get you some of Jesus, right? But go on what it says. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So this message that I'm sharing about that sin is a big deal, what do people do? They just suppress it. They just try to push it to the side and say, oh, this really isn't a big deal. And it's interesting that the two things that John deals with here is that there's a lie out there, even in his day, that would say, oh, you're not a sinner. You're not born a sinner. That's the first thing he deals with in verse 8. But he says, if you say that we don't have this sin problem, that we're not born separated from God, void of spiritual life, if you're arguing against that, then what does it say? You're deceived. The truth is not in you, because what is the truth? Yeah, you are a sinner. You deserve to die. You deserve God's wrath. But thank God, Jesus is the Savior. we take this verse and we stick it in the pocket of a believer, and we tell that believer, oh, you just pull this one out every single time that you do something wrong. And I'm telling you, the language doesn't say that. But yet we use this verse to live selfishly. But notice what it says. God's saying you don't have to lie. You don't have to deny the sin problem in your life. You need to agree with God about it, which is what confession means. And I just want you to notice what happens if we confess our sins. If we agree with God about it, look what he does. He's faithful. He's not going to turn anybody down, and he's just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Hey, isn't that great? You don't have to play games with this or act like it's not a big deal. Just agree with God and accept his provision. So if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and the word is not in us. So there again. You don't have to hide this. Last two verses, verse 1 and 2. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. There's your challenge, graduate. That you may not sin. Some of you knuckleheads out there, and myself included, you're taking this freedom you got, and you're absolutely abusing it. Man, you're going down paths. And I'm telling you, in your wicked little crazy mind, you think it's going to somehow work out. But I'm here to tell you by the word of God, God didn't give you this wonderful, glorious, saving privilege that you have to go out here and use it selfishly on yourself. I'm writing to you that you may not sin. Just like Jesus told the adulterous woman, go and sin no more. Hey, stop missing the mark. You have discovered the truth. Jesus is Christ, but not only the Christ, but he is Lord. Make yourself a bondslave to him and live. And here's the beauty of it. But if you do sin, that's what it says. But if you do, because the reality is you will. But if you do, just need you to know something. You have an advocate. You have a helper. You have a defense attorney. And he is with the Father, and his name is Jesus Christ. He is the righteous one. Aren't you glad he's the one that represents you at all times? And it says that he himself, man, notice the major emphasis, he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. And you might just be asking, how in the world can God take those of us who are clearly guilty, deserving of his wrath, how can he take those of us who are clearly guilty and make it any other way? Well, here's the beauty. Jesus Christ, he himself is your propitiation. You know what the glory of the gospel is? He stepped in for you. And he died on your behalf. He took every bit of wrath, every bit of death that you deserve so that you would never, ever, ever have to face it. And the beauty of that word propitiation, it's the word satisfaction. It means that what Christ did in your behalf 2,000 years ago, God looked on it and he was completely satisfied. Glory, hallelujah. And when you see his willingness to come, to lay aside the form of God, to take on the form of a bondslave, and be obedient, and not just obedient, but to be obedient, not just to any death, but the death of the cross. And you see what he suffered and how his life ended, and knowing that was all what Matt Rummage deserved. And that it's completely gone. Sin is taken out of the way. And when you take sin out of the way, as the Lamb of God did, if you have no sin, guess what? You have no death, and you have no more wrath. So if you find your refuge and safety in Christ, then you're safe. Because he is God's provision. But if you're out here, and you're trusting yourself, and you've never come to Christ, then the only thing you can look forward to is the death you deserve and the wrath you deserve. And so I don't know about y'all, but man, God knows my heart. I treasure Christ. I'm just like God when it hits the fan, I'm just like, God, don't let me think for a second. Don't let me put myself ahead of you for 1 second. Because this is true. And you, my friend, have an opportunity to believe the gospel today, period. And be saved from yourself. Be saved from wasting your life. I don't care what kind of example your parents have led. I don't care what kind of example they've led. What are you going to do, man? What will you do with Jesus? God help us. We thank you. We praise you. Thank you for allowing me the privilege to share the good news. Not sure how it was heard, Lord, but only you can awaken us to see, to truly hear. I can't help but thank God. If you led me to share this, then there's no doubt in my mind that there's somebody needed to hear it. Somebody needed to hear it. So I just pray, God, that the light comes on. Maybe it already has. Pray that Christ will be believed as the one and only Savior, the only hope, but yet the sufficient one who has taken away the sins of the world. So, Father, thank you. I pray for myself as I go forward in this life that I won't pursue sin, that I won't let sin in, that I won't give it any attention at all, that I will want to walk that path. Righteousness. God, to set an example for the world that's coming behind us. God, thank you. Love you. We trust you to move and work. Bring this.